Welcome to the lecture number 26 of the deep learning course. In this session, we are going to continue with the RNN, and we are going to see that what is the mathematical model into the RNN, what is the mathematics, and how the things are actually represented. So I would just quickly go back one slide before what we have did in the last class. We have seen that the RNN architecture that we have seen and we have discussed in the last class is going to be this box. So sometime it may happen that I'm going to provide something and I'm going to get some output. In this kind of setting, if I want to utilize the same thing multiple number of time, so whatever output I'm going to get, I'm going to again feed to this particular system and get one more output. And I keep doing this until I get some meaningful kind of output. This structure, we would be exploring into the more detail very soon. Next kind of arrangement could be that you have something and you are feeding something, but what happens that the output that you are going to get is also available without feeding something. Next time you are not feeding something, maybe in you are feeding null or something like that, and you are going to get multiple output until you get something that output has been exhausted, some kind of signal that you get from the network, you stop. You keep doing and after that you stop. So you are going to get this kind of scenario when, for example, there is an image you feed to the system and you are going to see the description of that particular image. Another chance that we have seen that you are going to feed something and you are at the end you are going to get something. So this may be a long sentence and you want to predict that who is the speaker or what is the meaning of that particular thing or what is the sentiment of that particular tweet, like that. You are feeding multiple things which are there, multiple words you are feeding at multiple point of time. These things are all shown at the multiple point of time. Here, this is the fourth arrangement where I'm feeding something, getting some output with a delay. And this could be a scenario when you are going to convert one language, translate one language into another language, such as English to French, English to Hindi, Hindi to any other language. So these are the four things that we have seen in the last class. And we have also discussed that if we see from the very high level perspective, you must understand that there is something input is being given to the system at the time n. Let me say that input is xn, and then to the system it is going to be u multiplied by xn, because there are some weights associated that are multiplied with the input. Let us call it u. There is some weight that are multiplied. Previous state, again there is a weight, let me call it w. So it is multiplied with the w and then goes to the system and provide you that what is the output at that particular place. So if you want to find out that what is the output at the time n, so you have to find out that what is input. Input is xn multiplied by u and sn minus 1 multiplied by w. These two things, and you find out the summation of this thing, apply some kind of activation on this to get that what is the next state. So this is how we find out what is the next state. If you want to track that what is going to be the output is going to be dependent upon the state. So you say that output is equal to yn is equal to sigma I dot v multiplied by sn. So this is what the complete formulation that we have. Let's assume that there is some place where only few words are there. For example, there is a word called h, e, l, o. These are the four words are only there. Okay, in some word there is four words are there. And since I have told you that if you want to feed h to the system, you need to have a code. Let's assume that the code is 100. For e is equal to 0100, l is equal to 010, and o is equal to 0001. Let's assume that these are the codes for these things. Okay, let's assume that these are the codes. So only four words are there, and let me design a RNN in such a way so that when I feed h, it gives me e. So I started by h, I got e. Then I feed e, I get h e l. I get l. So I write l over here. Then I feed l into the system, and I get again l. Then I write l. Next l, the same l I am going to feed to the system. Then I get o. So it becomes h e l l o. Then I feed O to the system, it give me end of file or some kind of character, exit character. So I exit to this particular thing and I say that hello had been obtained by this particular RNN. Problem is clear? I am going to design a RNN in such a way so that if I feed a particular word, I'm going to get the next word. I'm going to feed the same word over here. I'm going to get the next word over here. All right. So this is a kind of representation of the same thing where I'm telling that I'm going to feed H, I get E, then I feed E, then I get L, again I feed L, I get L, again I feed L, I get O. So H, E, L, L, O, this is what I'm going to get. So how can I get E as an output when I feed H? Definitely there will be some weight into the system. These weights are multiplied by this particular value. Let's assume that these are the weights, 3 minus 1 minus 0.19. They are multiplied and we get that what is the value of these, all these things, and we somehow get these values. Let's assume that these are the values. So what is this represent? So you know that the words are only like this: 1000100100100001. But this is the output. What you can say that what is this output is? This is none of these, because neither it is H, E, L, nothing is like that. But again, you can find out. Let's say we can assume these things as a probability of these bits to be one, and highest probability comes out to be at this particular place. And therefore, this thing comes to be what? The last one, O. So what is the output? What is the output? Output is going to be O. Output is going to be O. I expected E. I got O. It's a bad thing. So let's assume that when I feed E, I got this thing. What is the output? Here you can say that largest value is going to be, largest value is 1.2. So again, it is O. I wanted L, but it is going to give me O. Here what is going to happen? Here you say that into the third one, 1.9 is the largest value. So output is going to be the third one. What is the third one? Third one is L. So here I get L. I think at one place I'm right. Okay. Into the fourth one, what is the output? It is O. So I think here also I'm out. I'm right. Am I right? Or am I doing any mistake? So what is the problem when I'm going to train this particular system? So ultimately my objective would be to change these parameters in such a way so that I get E, L, L, and O. Two places there is some problem. What is that problem? We have to find out that if the output, expected output is E and I'm going to output O, what is the, what, how much it is bad? So maybe some distance metrics we can utilize to find out that what is the distance between E and O. So here the distance would be zero. Here also the distance would be zero. So if I, into the overall system, if I want to find out that how bad this particular, right now, the what is the state of my RNN is, so I can find out the summation of that the error function, or let me call it J. So the J, J at the, when I provide EO, J, I, O, J, L, L, N, J, O, O. The summation of these four terms is going to be the total problem into the my system. Okay, total problem in my system. So this is how I can define that what is my error is, and then we can try to improve this particular thing. Hope you understand this particular thing. Any questions if you have, please let me know that in this general model, any questions if you have? Any questions? So,
sir, by calculating the distance, do we convert our, let's say we obtain O, so we convert then O and target E. So is it between O and E, or we scale down this output that we obtained in 0 and 1 and then compute the distance?
Look, this, forget about this value. First of this, that forget about this value. Okay, exactly. Instead of these values, what is going to come out is that you take the maximum at one place and put all over places zero.
Yeah.
So you have to find out the distance between this value and what is expected value. Okay. Distance between those things only.
Okay.
So this, there would be a function that term by term going to find out that how much bad I'm in each step I am, and there is a summation. So ultimately, this is we have studied till now, that we had a RNN based model. And there was some initial state, and we provided some input, and we got some output. and the same state has been forwarded to the next one, and then we provide the input at the next point of time. Then we again provide the input at next point of time using this particular state. I'm going to find out that what is output. We keep doing this until the last input that we have, we can provide to the system and we get the final output. In all these cases, we have seen that if you want to find out the output at this particular yi place, it is a multiplication of v transpose into si. I think there is a sigmoid that we have talked about. I think I have to check this, that here it is a sigmoid, okay? So if you want to find out that what is the output non-linearity, this is multiplied with by this, and there is a non-linearity also. So what is the output? There is an output. If you want to find out that what is the state, as we have seen, that u multiplied by x and state multiplied by w, these two things, and then you apply a sigmoid. Loss at the time t, if any particular time, if you want to find out that what is the loss at this particular time, so you have to see this particular value, okay, and see that what is the output. So expected value, what is expected, what is the probability of ultimately you want to represent this, whatever the difference of this particular value and the value that you are going to expect, then the difference is going to be something that what is the probability that this is the output. Whatever the output you are going to say get, you are going to represent as a probability. What is the probability that this is an output? So if probability is 1, means you are correct, otherwise you are not correct, okay? So sometimes you can utilize a log also on this particular value, so that log of 1 is 0. Other values are going to contribute something, negative log of that particular quantity. Somehow you find out that whatever you are going to get, what is the probability of that particular thing that to be right. And across all the time, you are going to find out the summation. By this, you say that this is what my problem is, means total error is. Ultimate question would be that how to find out the right parameter over here. So who are the parameter? Okay. So parameter is W, parameter is U, parameter is V. These four, three things that we want to find out. If you want to find out that what is the value of W, same method that we are using for very long is going to be, can be utilized, that you use a learning factor, find out what is the derivative of this particular loss function with respect to the W, and you can update this thing, the weight with respect to this formula. We all know this. Huh? So in the same way, U and V can also be updated into the similar way. So again, how to train this RNN? So as we have discussed that we are going to find out what is the derivative of this particular quantity with respect to that particular weight. So let us pick one of them, say W, and we want to find out that what is the value of that particular W, new W. So as a few minutes back, we have written that W is equal to W minus alpha time del J upon del W. And since this J is a summation of all many terms, so there is no problem if I take that thing inside, if I take this, if I put the summation term over here, summation of this J, once again, this J, that is a loss function, is a summation of at various times. So I'm just writing that it is a summation of different times. And then derivative can go inside and find out the derivative of individual term. You know that this is perfectly fine because the derivative of the summation is the summation of individual term, derivatives of the individual term. So this is what is the right equation that we have. Any problem in that? So let us just focus on this particular quantity. That is, I'm going to find out the derivative of this particular J with respect to the W. So if I want to find out this this derivative, what I have written. Okay. So how many terms are there? So that would be, means how many such terms would be there? This depends upon the input size, that what is the input I have given. Okay. For a particular term, let's assume the I term, I want to find out that what is the value of this particular quantity. So let me represent it as del ji upon del w. So we can apply a chain rule, as we know that this is derivative can be find respect to the SI, and derivative of SI with respect to the W. Okay, so we know that how to find out the JI. JI is equal to sigmoid of, few minutes back we have called using this particular formula, JI is equal to, what is the JI? it is dependent upon actual value minus sigma I dot, whatever you are going to get, V multiplied by SI. Okay. So derivative of this actual value is going to be zero. Derivative of this term only remains. So finding out this derivative is not difficult. You know that sigma I derivative of sigma I is going to be sigma I of that particular SI, one minus SI, derivative of SI. So this thing you can find out. That's very easy. Finding out this term is, you know that how to find out the derivative. But this term is a bit complicated. Why? Because SI depends upon SI minus 1. Because SI depends upon SI minus 1, SI minus 2, SI minus 3, because everything is going to be dependent. How can I can get this state? And all of those are actually dependent upon the W. So I cannot take it independently that they are independent. All of those terms are actually again having the W term into them. So it is a difficult part that we have to find out that what is the derivative. So let us just focus on this thing, this second part. What is the derivative of SI? Derivative of SI with respect to W. Let us just focus on this particular thing. Okay. So you know that SI is, a few minutes back we have defined in this particular way, that it is a sigmoid of XI multiplied by U and SI minus 1 multiplied by W. Transpose, forget about the transpose, because they are used in such a way so that the multiplication is possible. Okay. So whenever these kind of scenarios arise into the calculus, you know that these kind of things have two different parts. One is the implicit part and another is explicit part. And what does it mean? That into the explicit part, we assume that things are actually constant, and then we can do the direct differentiation over there. And the next part, we say that they are not going to be constant, and then we have to find out the derivative. So this explicit part, here is a small notational difference that we are going to use, that it is a del plus. I'm going to write del plus, that says that there is an explicit part and this is the implicit part. Implicit part is once again the same thing. Here again, I can apply this chain rule. I can say there's minus one and S minus one with respect to the W. So if you see these two equations, you see that the same thing is here with the something is lesser than that. On the same thing, I can apply the same concept over here, and I can say that there is an explicit part and of S minus 1, and there is S minus 1, S minus 2 part, and there is this particular part with S minus 2. Same thing I can extend, and I can go extending until I reach to the S0, because when the first item is there, it is not dependent upon anything previously, then I can start at this particular moment. So if you just pick the last one or anything in between, so there would be something as I minus K divided by del W. So what would be before that? So you see that it would be del S I minus K divided by S I K minus one, one more item. And all other items are actually there outside, they are getting multiplied. So every multiplication term would also be there. So del SI upon del SI minus 1, del SI minus 1, del SI minus 2. So many multiplication terms. So all the multiplication term would be here, they are going to be multiplied. And at the end, there would be one term. This is a complex mathematical equation. So you need not to be immediately understand this thing. What is important to be understood is that let me do a kind of short circuit. I say that these things are actually somehow removed, and this divided by this value, I can directly write. I can say that various terms are there. So I can say that it is going to be the summation of something. Summation of k is equal to 1 to I del SI SK. And this is the explicit part, del plus SK del W. Okay. So this is this part that is this long multiplication part. Okay, let me just focus on this particular part. So let us say that somehow I can find out this thing. This is a single value, but this is the multiplication of many values. What is this multiplication? If you just pick this particular part, it is a multiplication of various parts. And let us just focus on this particular part. Okay, need not to go into that much mathematical detail. So I just wanted to tell that focus on this particular part. Okay, so multiple things are there. They are multiplied. I can write an equation that there is a multiplication of multiple part. In this multiplication, focus on any particular part, this particular part what is this? Si del of si divided by del of si minus 1. This is something like that. Okay, it is something like that. So you know that si is equal to sigmoid of some quantity. So you can say that, let me call it A. So I can say that del of si with respect to del of A, del of A divided by del of si minus 1. I can write like this also, where A is something, because you know that si minus 1 has been computed using the si, si has been computed using si minus 1 value. So this thing is an important component, and this part which is actually here is again the sigmoid, means sigmoid and 1 minus sigmoid kind of thing. Ultimately, what is important in this particular equation is this, that if there are two terms and we want to find out that what is the maximum value of this particular quantity, and you know that sigmoid, the maximum derivative of maximum value of this particular quantity is going to be upper bounded by 1 by 4. Similarly, there is also W can also be upper bounded with some value. I don't know that. Let's assume that there is some value, because let's assume that the weight are going to saturate at some point of time, and we can say that some value is going to be maximum. So if we very highly high perspective try to see, we can say that this particular quantity, which is a single quantity, is actually upper bounded, and that is actually dependent upon the W, and it is the upper bounded value. So this is the only important part that I wanted to tell right now, that there are multiple terms that are going to come over here, and somehow they are actually upper bounded. Okay, and if, let me call it that value to be C. Okay, I think mathematical part is over. Try to understand this part in a very simple way. What I wanted to tell is this, that once again, there was a long chain of multiplications. If you pick any particular term, I am going to say that it is upper bounded by a value C. C can be anything. If the C is less than 1, and you are multiplying with the multiple with the many of the times, what is going to happen? For example, if you take any small value, 0.9, multiply with some itself, 0.9, within few minutes, you can say that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Into the 9 multiplication step, it becomes 0.39. 0.9, which is a big value, becomes 0.39. Okay. 0.9, when it is multiplied, it becomes 0.39. If it is greater than 1, 1.5, for example, let's assume it is 1.5, it is multiplied 2.25, and similarly within few minutes, it becomes 25. Larger value explodes. And the lesser value, if C is less than 1, then it vanishes. And if it is greater than 1, it actually explodes. It becomes very large value. And you know that this importance of this particular quantity is this, that this value is multiplied by this particular quantity, and there is a summation. So if it is very large, it actually amplifies. So what does it mean? That if it is less than 0, if it is less than 1, then you are not learning. Your weights are actually, when the change in weight is going to vanish, means what? You are not learning at all. When changes weight is greater than 1, it means that you are exploding, means the value changes very, very high. Again, you are going to not see the things into the right perspective. So in both the cases, you are not able to train your RNN model. This is the problem. So this is a big problem into the RNN, that this particular problem is called the vanishing and exploding gradient problem, that arises because of this complex mathematical scenario that leads to the very high or very low value of the gradient change that we are going to do. So what could be the workaround around this particular problem? So one method could be that you take some step, because you don't want to stop. So you say that I would take some step by having this, that if the value is going to be greater than some threshold, I say that I would not use the larger value, I will use this threshold. For example, what I say that if the value is greater than 1.5, it becomes 25, but I'm going to use 1.5. This is the one threshold. Another threshold could be 0.6, if, for example, if the value becomes 0.001, I would use 0.6 rather than the 0.001. So there are two different thresholds. One is a lower threshold and another is a upper threshold. If the value goes below the lower threshold, I use this value, and I would use this higher threshold to update the value. This works, okay? In many scenarios, this particular method works. Another approach could be that you don't look, because why it is a problem? Because I'm going to multiply many terms. So it says that you only use this particular part, some part, some length. Don't use the complete length over here, okay? For example, you say that I'm going to truncate this multiplication to these many terms only and use this gradient to only update the things. But again, if you are, this is called the truncated back propagation. But again, there is a problem that if you utilize this kind of thing, long-term dependencies, you cannot represent. Because if there is something that is going to make effect on this particular quantity, you cannot do with that. The third method is actually most important method, that is called the LSTM. And it is a special kind of neural network circuit where there are four different circuits, okay? Where there are four different circuits, they are actually deployed to find out that what to forget, what to learn, what to change, etc. And by this, they effectively can provide you the value that can, so that the network can be trained. So this is a separate topic. We would be seeing into the next class that how the LSTM actually works. So you would see into the next class. So that's all for today. So please ask me if you have